Hi, I'm Elisa. I'm an electrical engineer. Most people, when they first meet me, are very surprised to learn that. I'm not what they think about when they think about what an engineer is. When they think about an engineer, they think of somebody with dark-rimmed glasses and a pocket protector. Have you heard the joke, what's the difference between an introvert and an extrovert engineer? An extrovert looks at your shoes, not his own. When I was an undergraduate at RPI in the 1980s, I came across this thing called the jargon file, developed by computer science students at MIT and Stanford. It's a bunch of tongue-in-cheek definitions of computing terms. One of the ones I love from there is computer geek. It's a noun. One who eats computer bugs for a living. One who fulfills all the dreariest negative stereotypes of a hacker. An asocial, malodorous, pasty-faced monomaniac with all the personality of a cheese grater. We know how to laugh at ourselves. And while all stereotypes have some truth, I'm here today to show you another side of engineering. When people think about what engineers do, electrical engineers particularly, they think of building circuits, radios, maybe your power grids. If we're in Boise, maybe they also think about computer memory or printers. We do quite a bit more than that. Some people know that engineers do a lot of humanitarian development. We bring power and lighting to worlds, to remote villages around the world. We develop tools for people with special needs. We write cell phone apps that can bring a basic level of health care to remote villages. The tagline for the Electrical Engineering Professional Society, IEEE, is advancing technology for humanity. In addition to doing projects that are humanitarian, we actually do projects directly for the humanities, like history, literature, art, philosophy. You can think of these as mysteries, where we're using engineering as a tool to help unravel these mysteries. There's a field called digital humanities, which is applying the computational tools to the humanities. A lot of these projects start by digitizing a book or a piece of artwork. But what's more important is the analysis that follows and the understanding it can enable. I've been able to work on a lot of interesting projects in my career, and I'm going to tell you about three of them to give you a feeling for how engineering can affect these humanity projects. We're going to take a little time machine trip. Are you ready? Ready. We're going to go back about a century to the First World War, which is widely considered to be the first industrialized war in history. Technology led to a lot of advancements that supported the soldiers on the front line and was used by the civilians at home in support of those soldiers. Technology also played a large role in the development of the military postal service. During my sabbatical at the Technical University in Dortmund, I worked with a historian who studies World War I through the postal trail. During World War I, there were 28 billion mail pieces shipped between the military front line and the home front and vice versa. On any given day, 18 million pieces of mail were shipped. Of those, there were parcels, letters, and 25% of them were postcards. This historian is working to study World War I through those postcards. Now, individually, a postcard doesn't say very much. It's very small. There's only a small space on which you can write. You can think of these postcards as the tweets and instant messages of World War I. They're examples of everyday communication, and they're really rich in historical, cultural, and linguistic information. And we want to unravel these mysteries and study these. But because there were so many, doing everything manually is not practical. So that's where we come in, bringing in automated tools to help in this understanding. We cannot do automatic transcription, but we can still help. Here's an example of a postcard. And as you can see, one of the problems we have with the postcards is that the ink is very faded and the paper is very yellowed. This makes it very difficult for people to read and transcribe what is written there. I've developed a tool to increase the contrast, making it much easier for that transcription to take place. We want to know what was written on it, as well as to whom it was sent. The vertical line, if I can automatically identify that, can help separate those pieces of information to target where we are reading. The horizontal lines tell you where the address is. I can automatically identify where those lines are, and I can even remove it to make reading those addresses easier. The postage stamps are always of interest, but they've all been canceled. I can remove the cancellation mark. But really, it's the cancellation mark that contains all of the information. It says from where it was sent, and quite often the date on which it was sent. So I can make the stamp disappear. So now you can read the cancellation mark. Here's another example, just because they're so pretty to look at. We have these stamps and we have these cancellation marks, and they're always intertwined with that text we really want to read. We can make the text disappear to study those postmarks and those stamps, and we can make those stamps disappear, and now we can read that text a lot easier. With all this analysis, we can find out a lot more about the people, their history, and their humanity. The next stop on our trip is going to be going back several hundred years, shortly after the invention of the printing press. With the printing press, the old styled ones, lead type was inked and pressed to the paper to form these paper documents. These lead pieces contain a lot of information. They tell the history of printing. They tell the artistry of the design of the type, and they tell the history of the artisans and how they were influenced by other artisans as time evolved and they interacted with each other. We want to study that lead type. But most of those lead type pieces were either lost or melted down to form something else. So therefore, how can we study them if they're no longer with us? The answer is in those pages of text which still remain in libraries and museums around the world. With that, we can reconstruct those lead type pieces and then use that for further study. Already, we have found that the type is not as uniform as previously thought. Take this document, for instance, and here's 11 D's from that document. The serifs, or those flags at the top, occur at many different angles. The serifs at the bottom extend out different amounts. We no longer think that the artisans would buy type in a complete set. Maybe their first startup, but not afterwards. When pieces were lost, they would then just order replacements when the artisans came to town. I'll take 2 D's, 5 A's, and 10 E's, please. What else? Well, on your home PC, the typical word processing program, you have access to 100 different fonts with which you can create documents which can fit your mood and your whatever you're trying to accomplish. If you spend a little bit more money, you can go on the internet and you can easily, inexpensively, buy 1,000 more fonts to add to your creativity. We can take these documents, and by inspecting those letters, we can extract the shapes of those characters, put them into computerized form, and use them as a font to print documents looking like something from several centuries ago. Now, why might we want to do this? Take this document as an example. How many of you read Middle French? Okay, I see one hand. We can transcribe what was written there. We can correct for the typography conventions of that ancient time. We can translate it to modern French. How many of you can read modern French? Okay, a few more hands are showing up. We can translate it to English. All the hands should go up now. But now you're reading something that looks like it was printed yesterday. If I use this old font and print it on old paper, you now have the feeling of reading an old document without investing years in studying Middle French. This is the same same reason why if you go to a history museum, you see the docents dressed in a costume. It brings more of your senses into the experience and makes it a richer experience for you. The next stop on our journey with our magic time machine is not back a couple hundred years, but we're now going to go back 2,000 years to the Middle East, to the area near Qumran, in the famous Dead Sea Scrolls. Starting in 1947, when the first Dead Sea Scrolls were found, they have made a marvel for people as they've wondered, what do they say, and why were they there, and what can we learn from them? Over the course of a decade, in 11 caves, about 1,000 scrolls were found. Due to poor handling and the effects of time, we now have about 10,000 fragments we need to interpret. Technology is helping this considerably. For instance, in January 2018, they were able to take several of the pieces and put them together like a jigsaw puzzle. And then from there, they discovered that the name of a festival that the people 2,000 years ago used to describe the changing of the seasons was called Tekufa, which means cycle in Hebrew. In May 2018, on pieces of fragment that looked like they were blank under visible light, they used an imaging system developed at NASA, and they were able to see that with infrared light, there was actually text on them. And when they put them together, they discovered that Psalm 147, verse 1, that was used 2,000 years ago by these people, was shorter than what we use now. They also discovered that they do indeed have a third copy of the temple scroll describing the ideal ceremonies to be used in the ideal temple. And they found that they have a third example of a document written in Paleo-Hebrew, which will add greatly to linguistic studies. 80% of these documents are written on leather or parchment. 20% of them are on papyrus. But one scroll, scroll 3Q15, discovered in 1952, is made of copper. It contains a treasure map. They think it's dated from 25 to 100 AD, and they still have not found the treasure. I've started working with a collector who has another copy of a scroll made of copper, reportedly from Qumran. This scroll was legally obtained. It was in the United States before 1970 UNESCO Convention on methods to prohibit the illegal and illicit transfer, import, export, and transfer of ownership of cultural property. It's very wrinkled because over the course of time, it's been rolled and unrolled several times. And it's now very difficult to tell what is text because it's not ink on paper, it was impressions made into it. So it's hard to tell what is text and what is wrinkle. Think of the aluminum foil on your leftover barbecued chicken. To make matters worse, the previous owner had used tape to affix it to a frame, which makes it even harder to read. We've done some high-resolution imaging on this scroll, including doing a three-dimensional model of it. So now on the computer, I can look at this in three dimensions mathematically. And I can take the three-dimensional map and I can virtually flatten it. And with that, with a little bit of additional image processing techniques, we're starting to see things which we think are the characters. Now we need to figure out what it says. This mystery is not complete. There's still a lot of work to be done. We still want to know, how old is it? Where is it from? What does it say? For whom was the message intended? And most importantly, what is its historical significance? Because there's only one other exemplar of a copper scroll in existence, understanding the cultural and historical context of that one will be greatly expanded if we can interpret, if we can uncover the secrets of this scroll. This is not complete. I told you we have mysteries, and this mystery is still in progress. Stay tuned. Computers and electrical engineering can be applied to the humanities, books, scrolls, postcards, artwork. They enable you to travel through time. They let you look at historical artifacts in distant places. You can see what people were doing and ask why. This is not science fiction or fantasy. This is science fact. And the fantasy is in the questions you can imagine to ask, in the answers to the questions we may find out. Electrical engineering and computer science make tools that can make an impact on the humanities. There are still lots of unanswered questions. I invite you to think about those unanswered questions and what other projects can electrical engineering and computer science be applied to help unlock these mysteries. They're all around us. Thank you.